users in a super competitive market space. So we have now from the panelists includes John is from AppLovin, and I also have Anton from Wungl. May I have you guys come in? So Janish from AppLovin and Anton from Wungl, and I also have Siddharth from PlaySimple, pretty exciting company there. This would be moderated by Ishwar, worked in Zynga, and now he has a stealth mode startup. So great, so look for an interesting session now.
Before you start, so how many of you think here the market is very competitive now? True, right? In 2014, there were about 200,000 games in the App Store. Now that number is about 800,000. Great. So the agenda of this chat is to get inside info on companies that are very successful in getting revenue, generating revenue from advertising, acquiring users from advertising. So we have one successful company and two platforms. So I'll let them introduce themselves.
Three successful companies.
Yes, absolutely.
Anyways, so my name is Anton. I'm the general manager of Southeast Asia and Australia for Wungl, based in Singapore. So our office manages companies in India, all over Southeast Asia, and Australia and New Zealand.
Hey, I'm Johannes. I'm the managing director for our international business. For those of you that have heard of AppLovin, we're the monetization platform. So basically partner up with developers all over the world to help them to acquire users and monetize them. We don't have an office here in the area yet, but depending on how the market actually evolves, it might actually happen in the short future.
Hi guys, I'm Sam, co-founder of PlaySimple Games. We started this company around 3 years back with a vision to make fun and social mobile games, and that's what we've been working at. So,
I'm going to start with you. So the gaming market obviously has gotten very competitive over the last few years. So how do you see that?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. The market is changing at a very rapid pace. If we talk about the Indian market, that will be growing around 50% over here with the Reliance Jio coming in that capacity. In terms of people who were playing games online, that is also growing. Mobile in itself has contributed a major revenue market. So what was around a few billion dollars earlier, around like 5 to 6 years back, would be contributing around 40 to 50 billion dollars right now. So definitely, market is growing competitively.
And how does a small company actually do something in this market? You guys have something fantastic with your games.
I mean, the thing that we have always followed is, we are really small right now, so the thing that we always follow is make it quickly and get it out to the masses. We do not wait for a very long time, test it out, try it out with the people, get the feedback as soon as possible, understand what the players like and what they don't like. I mean, understand what is in there for the players and then adapt accordingly.
How fast is fast?
So basically, if we start on a game, we would make sure that we get the first prototype in a, let's say, max a month's time. And then I think we'll be changing and adapt the game as the game moves.
That's 1 month game. Wow. That's amazing. So a question for Anton. Can you give us some example of games that are very successful and are very profitable just on ad monetization?
Yeah, I mean, let's just start with a local company. So I think, you know, the game Ludo King has been extremely successful. You know, they took a very popular game and utilized ads to make money. So obviously you need a massive user base, which they've been able to achieve. But within India, I think that's very achievable. And then globally, there are games such as Color Switch out of Australia. They make only money from advertising. They have been able to be in the top 100 games for over, I think, a year. So there's an endless amount of games that are just making money on ads, but I think what you're seeing as well is the games that make a lot of money in in-app purchases, companies such as Playrix, they're actually utilizing ad monetization just as much as they're thinking about their in-app purchases.
Great. And in terms of ad monetization, what do you think are some good strategies that these games are using?
Well, they're thinking about ads prior to launch. So I would say a few years ago, I would have conversations with people say, great ad.
Jonas, what do you have to add on the topic?
So when it comes to like great ad integration, so one thing I really like is any kind of idle game. So I don't know if you've already played it, but like the great thing is that like within idle games, you usually have a mechanic that uses rewarded ads in order to basically earn virtual currency faster. And there are even games that utilize rewarded ads as retention tool. So basically, they send out a push notification to the user every 4 hours that now there's a new rewarded video available. So if you get back to the game, then you can actually earn more virtual currency. So, and I think this is kind of like, so it's obviously can't apply to every game, but it's a great example how like native rewarded video can be integrated within the experience. And there hasn't been like a lot of creativity around it, but I think idle games are a great example for the potential, and also the way how they integrate it is really like the users progress like way faster if they actually understand how to use them. Another like great example that I'd actually like to touch base on, Color Switch, which is a great example for games that are very simple, usually arcade styles, and they mainly monetize the audience through ads. So, and that's also something that they get across in a very straightforward way. And I think that's also another important aspect, as in the user needs to be prepared that's like what they actually get for the ads. And if they, for example, can extend, so like one run in Color Switch or what a video impression, that's a pretty good deal. So if you already, play for a minute, you had a great run, you want to continue, rewarded integration enables you to do this without paying. So I think that's the way how to think about it, and that requires thinking about ads early on in the process, not necessarily like the first thing, but being creative and utilizing ads in a way that really fits into your game is critical. Also for the performance, that's also something that I'd like to stress over and over again. It's the better the users perform for the games that the advertisers, so for the advertisers, the more you get for your placement as well. So think about it. So think about ways the quality of the user is good, so that the advertisers like to pay more for the placements that you offer.
Great. So Anton, you talked about having ad integration earlier in the stage, right? And is it a good idea to approach you guys during that phase, or do you say something like you guys should be approached once they have a scale?
Thank you. If you've never, or if you're not using ads, yeah, you definitely want to be talking to, the ad providers that you find interesting prior to launch. And, I think as you're planning a game, I think as Adan said, obviously focus on your game first, but normally when people approach us is they say, hey, we're just about to soft launch, and we're working out the final tweaks, and we're starting to integrate the ads and figure out where it fits in. That's a great time to kind of really touch base with an ad network.
And in terms of games, what kind of data that they can give up to their users so they can maximize the inventory?
What kind of data can they provide us?
Yes. Both the users that the game team can provide to the ad networks.
You can comment as well, but I think a lot of companies are starting to experiment with passing back Facebook data. Obviously, some cohort data would be very interesting so that we can target off of that, as well as things like gender and geographical data. Those are things that are obviously interesting. companies are, I know, I'm sure Apple is doing the same, but starting to ingest that data for their ad models, and they can adjust their algorithms to target users.
So, so data in general is always kind of like a bit of tricky, and like I think outside of Facebook there is not a lot of like the deterministic data, so that's critical, right? So like data that doesn't really say a lot about the user, so it's basically just acquired kind of like in a statistical way, is usually pretty much like nonsense. So if you provide data, it needs to be a deterministic data directly from the user. And frankly speaking, that's something that's not widely available in the off-social ecosystem. Therefore, we mainly optimize towards like understanding the audience of like a given placement and match it with the audience of the advertiser. So, yeah. So there is actually not so much more to that question in the first place.
Okay. Thanks. In terms of PlaySimple, so what kind of ad services do you use? What's the value that you see from them?
Ad placements,
what kind of ads work for you guys? What monetizes the most?
So in terms of ad placements, we obviously have all the different forms of ad placements. I mean, banner plays a different role, interstitial plays a different role, reward people, and Joanne has just mentioned that plays a very important role in having the retention and the interest in the game. Different ad placements play a different role at different point. I mean, some are mainly for revenue, other would be more for retention and all. In terms of ad networks that we work with, we work with almost all the ad networks. Majorly because each one of them is bringing something different to the table. For example, AppLovin and Wanga would have very high eCPM, so that really works for us in terms of having high revenue. And similarly, other ad networks will have different advantages across the other.
So do you guys differentiate between somebody who's paying in-app and not show them ads and show only non-pays ads? Do you do any of those targeting of your ads? Do you target your ads towards payers versus non-payers in your game?
Yeah, so inside the app, we would want to have, if someone's a payer for us, we would try to show him as less ads as possible and make the gameplay as streamlined as free as possible. So, I mean, there are different levels of optimization that we get. But yes, I mean, we do differentiate in terms of who's a payer for us and who's a non-payer for us, and depending we would shoot in different formats of that.
So I turn back to you. Wanted to check if do you observe any fine balance between showing too much of ads in a game versus doing too less an ad that you are not monetizing enough? So do you see any balance there, something that works as a golden rule?
Golden rule, probably not a golden rule, but there's definitely going to be retention issues if you're showing, users maybe pop-up ads or just interstitials that show up, too often. So, most of our publishers experiment with that. So, how many ads do I want to show per day? What is the impact on the retention? How many placements do I have? For non-paying users, those are the ones that I think people are showing more ads. They have a reward available quite often. But I see a lot of publishers limit ads to maybe just a few per day, right? So it just depends. I mean, idle games have different mechanisms, push notifications, things like that. So unfortunately, no, there's no golden rule. I don't know if you have any insights, John.
So it's the hot and fast test. Identify what works for you and then stick to it.
A very unsatisfying answer, yes.
Yeah, but like in general, like you have the advantage with the hundreds of thousand apps that's available. There are probably a couple of apps that are also like relatively similar to yours, so there's a lot of inspiration. And it's usually not that difficult to basically look at successful games in similar genre, get an understanding how they pace the ads and also benefit from that. So, but yeah, it's an individual.
My next question is to you, Jonas. So I read your Pocket Gamer articles. You seem to be having an interesting proportion of, a game that makes most of its money through ads can also acquire its users through ads. Yeah. How does that economics work?
So, so basically, one thing I'm very actively evangelizing to some extent are games that I personally call hyper-casual games. So the reason why hyper-casual is because they're very casual. And basically, they focus on a simple core loop, and they focus on scale. And they are mainly ad funded. So the cool thing about this is that there are a couple of companies that really dominate the charts. So I looked today, so the most downloaded app in the US for October is Dune from Voodoo. Basically, what you need and want if you monetize a media property with ads. And that's there, and a couple of companies really start to utilize that. And that starts with understanding the appeal of the game. You obviously also need to understand how to monetize the users properly, what is the right frequency, but also utilizing that in acquiring users. And the more and more of those apps are available, the also the easier it is to acquire users. So it's like it's a perfect storm that's being built there at the moment. And so in case you want to know more about it, talk to me.
Thank you. So Anton, so Wangal has been very clearly stating that videos are the best performing ads. So why is that? What kind of data that supported?
I think the company, I mean, when the company started, we stuck with video only, and I think that was an interesting bet. It panned out. I mean, banners were making a lot of money for people, and I think that is slowly decreasing, and we're starting to see static ads, full screen static ads start to decrease as well. The company started making video ads for publishers, actually, not as a network. So I think that's why we took that direction. And for us, we've just been able to focus on a single product, which I think has helped us get success. But what is giving success to other companies doing video is that it's just so much more engaging. You understand what the game is. Like, if you look at a movie trailer, for example, versus a poster of a movie, you understand what that movie is about. And that allows the user, when they see that ad, to actually say, oh, I actually might be interested in this. And then when they download that app, they actually understand what the game is in. So that's kind of why video, I think, is winning right now.
Great. And when people are thinking about making video ads for their own game, should they look at it like a cadence, that they should refresh their video ads at some frequency?
Yes. I mean, it's pretty much as much bandwidth as you have to make video ads, you should be doing that. I mean, most of the, you know, if you look at the top advertisers, they are running probably between 30 and 50 different, you know, versions, right? That's very hard to actually accomplish, but that is kind of where people need to go. And you never know what the audience is going to be interested in. Experiment what type of ads. I mean, if you look at Smule, I think their ads are filmed on an iPhone, and it does extremely well. So they don't necessarily need to be, high quality in the sense of, let's say you have a huge team working on it, but I think the content needs to be good.
Interesting.
Yeah, so this is actually exactly what happens. So it's easier than ever to have great It's considering you have a great app, right? So there's like a general tendency towards focusing more on gameplay. So, and this is pretty cool, because like if you look at ads as basically a tutorial, and then you have the possibility to actually get content in front of the user without paying for it before they actually download it, right? So like just if you do the math, you can address a lot of users and explain what the game itself is all about. So, and that's pretty cool, and that's also how I would think about ads, video ads in the first place. You can showcase your game to the user and literally only have the users that played your tutorial to some extent within the application. That's only what you pay for. And that's a massive change throughout like the last one and a half years. And you can literally do them like connecting your iPhone, your game to your computer and then iterate. So you need to scale in order to iterate, but sure, you'll figure out what is most interesting to a user. That's where to start, and then obviously you can also help them. That's like a great thing about like advertising companies. We can actually provide valuable feedback, so go for it.
And in terms of latest trends that's happening on the ad space, can you guys add what's the cutting edge happening in the ad industry?
Yeah, I mean, I think I mean, both our companies do this, which is playable ads. I mean, this is definitely the trend where going beyond actually viewing what the game is like, you can actually try them. Now, that only works for various types of games, but that is probably the biggest thing that we've seen as far as interaction, conversions, and that obviously results in better revenue for everybody. But that's probably the biggest change I've seen this year, I'd say.
And in terms of developers, what kind of tech is giving them most value for money? Like, most value per impression?
In general, like, our system basically just serves what performs best. And so if you have like iterations of like a couple of different setups, then we serve the one that actually performs best. And there are like different constellations, right? So yeah, for some games, playables are a game changer. For others, videos do the same or just even slightly better. But that's kind of like what you need to be in for, right? So you need to iterate like on the content, but the important aspect is that you're true and actually show the users what the whole thing is all about. There are not many concepts nowadays, there are a couple, but there are not many concepts nowadays that do the opposite and basically whatever, show like CGI content, which is more story driven or whatever. That's usually because they also want to hide what's coming then when you start playing the game.
And from PlaySimple side, you guys have a very short dev cycle, right, to test your games. So how much time do you take to integrate with ads, and how easy is the tech for it?
I mean, integrating ads is it's not that difficult. I think for something like a rewarded video, it's more about where you want to integrate it and how do you want to make it into the game. So integration cycle is typically not that long, I would say. Because all of these ad networks are working already with a lot of developers, so all that is, I don't know, so I would say max, let's say a week's time to get your ads at speed. That should be it.
Great. So in terms of suggestions, so what do you guys think that most of the developers do wrong in terms of ad monetization that's easy to fix and that will help them get more revenue per user?
Let's go first on this one, Jared.
So, one thing that we already mentioned, that's really considering your ad partners to be partners, right? So, we see a lot consistently, we see how the market evolves, and we are probably one of the best resources to provide feedback. And like, keep in mind that we're incentivized to help you, right? So like, the better integration is, the more money you make, the more money we make. So this is literally free advice, so utilize it. Starting with the technical stuff, right? So depending on what kind of mediation platform you use, you build it in-house, you use a third party, are you aware like what they actually fill, how they fill it, how much possibility do you have to do custom deals? That's like something that you should also be aware of, like in general, talking to the partners, ad partners make sense because they might have different offers, right? And sure, like it's not only competitive for you guys, it's also competitive for us. And that's like something that you should also always keep in mind, that it's important to talk to the major players and understand what they're offering. And then the standard advice that you probably always hear, iterate, right? So it's you probably can't find like the perfect integration right away. It will take a couple. It will need some data in order to find it. And you'll probably find it if you do the research.
I think just to piggyback off of that is I see sometimes a mistake. I think especially people who are brand new to the ad space is they look for just one partner. And I think there are tools such as mediation layers that help you work with multiple ad networks. It provides competition, like you're saying. But going with a single partner isn't really beneficial. And I think, I see it sometimes in the market where people say, oh, maybe it's simpler for me, or maybe even ad networks are pitching that. But I think in general, you definitely want to spread yourself with at least probably 2 to 3 partners just to give yourself diversity. They tend to have different value props, they provide different things, but that's probably a mistake that I've been seeing in the market just within kind of Southeast Asia in general. And then beyond that with integration, I think going a little bit too far and trying to provide too many ads is a major mistake. I mean, it's not necessary to have banners everywhere or to have an ad after every level. I think slowly progress into a test. I mean, if you look at the major players, a lot of them are testing on smaller portions of their user bases in the beginning stages to see how are people reacting to this rather than just kind of blanking. So I think go slowly is a advice I would give.
And what do you guys have as an advice for developers?
Yeah, I mean, as both of you guys mentioned, I mean, mediation is a must. I mean, going standalone with all the admins is obviously, and with mediation coming, it really helps to scale and probably add more inventory to your app. So definitely anyone who is planning to add maybe banners, maybe decisions, whatever you do consider mediation as a source before starting. Okay.
So in terms of trends of monetization, what kind of monetization or what kind of ad monetization will work in India? Do you have any suggestions?
Within India?
For Indian audience.
Yeah.
The developer has a lot of Indian audience. How can they monetize around that?
Sure. I mean, I guess that's maybe more of an advertiser question, but I mean, if you work with a network that has the capability to localize their ads, that is a huge thing. So in India, I mean, with the language differentiations, I mean, it's very important that you have an ad network that can adjust their language in their ads to match that. So I think that's a trend where we're seeing a huge increase in conversions when we change the language to match the locality.
Very interesting. And do you see any trends in terms of, because of the Indian and the phones that we have on the net, video ads versus banner ads, is there any choice that works better?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, on the lower end devices, it's definitely harder to serve video. I think pretty much every network is trying to solve how do we do that, and there's definitely been some improvements made. At the same time, I mean, I'm sure as everyone's seen in this room, is that those low-end devices end up being lower quality and lower value in the sense of how much money they make a publisher and advertiser. So typically, I mean, I think most people should adjust for their top-end devices. Obviously, you want a technology and ad tech that can serve ads to those lower-end devices, but where your money is being made is probably within those top-end devices.
Okay. Jonas, do you have any insight on India?
Yeah, so frankly speaking, India is a market which is also, like, the beautiful thing is we have like partners all over the world, but India is really like an emerging market for us to an extent that we unfortunately see like a relatively limited subset of sophisticated buyers, which is a huge challenge if you're like in the ad industry. So that means the sophisticated buyers, what I'm referring to is like on the one side, like having people that actually focus on user acquisition. That's like unfortunately something, or like in general, there are that's a lack of those qualifications like all over the world. But my impression, at least like so far, is that it's like a massive challenge here to have people that have previous experience in acquiring users. And also like understand like the ecosystem around it, and then there is like a tendency to basically trying to trick the systems in a way which doesn't work so well if you don't necessarily understand how they work. So I think there's it's a lot of, like there it's a lot about like education which comes with scale, which comes with opportunities, which comes with more success. And I see the quality going up literally like on a month-to-month basis. And I think I see definitely a golden future, but I think we're at the very beginning of that run. Sorry, I don't have more insights here.
Thank you. So Siddhant, a question for you. How can a studio from India target global? What you guys are doing different? How is it helping a place up?
So to target global, it's first of all, it's very important to understand what all players are there already existing in the market. It's very important to competitive research as to what people really like. And at the same time, quality is one thing that developers should always be focusing upon. because though we know that the number of apps that people are installing are increasing day by day, but the maximum percentage of the user time only goes in a fraction of apps. So I think quality would be one thing that any developer should keep in mind. And I think these couple of things do a very good competitive research, and quality is what one should be focusing on definitely to do global market.
A quick final question. So what's the maximum opt-out you've seen in an ad-supported game? Just to use.
The max,
you don't have to tell the game name, maximum opt-out you have ever seen in an ad-supported game.
Low double digit? Yeah, so ad-supported or permit, like ad-funded? Yeah, low double digit.
Ditto. Yeah, I mean, it depends on the game. I mean, if you have a RPG game, I mean, you can really have that. But those aren't just only ad-supported, so. It varies dramatically. I mean, I think the ultra-casual or super-casual, whatever you call it, I mean, it's very difficult to kind of drive that, but.
So it's always like also how much, I think the more important question is how much scale you can actually get there, right? So I think like whenever you talk about ads, scale is key, right? Not only because scale is great, but also because you actually, the scale also helps the advertising platform to do a better job, right? So there's always technology behind, technology needs machine, works better with data. The more data there is, the more they can actually do. And so therefore, I think like this, if you have like a smaller audience, then it's, in general, there's a tendency towards like more like an in-purchase approach to really trying to find your niche audience and monetize that as effectively as possible. If you have like the more mass appeal you have, the more important ads will get for you.
Do we have time to take questions? Do you have any questions? Sure.
Given that all of you are involved with ad networks, what are your thoughts about certain ad networks that claim to pit different networks against each other, make them bid against each other, and choose the best for you? Like there's a Russian company called AppOdeal, which is that, and there are half a dozen others who claim that they will pitch different networks against each other, and then during mediation they'll select the best paying one. So, I mean, to me it sounds controversial, to me it sounds a bit like snake oil to sort of seduce a game maker into taking only that network. But what are your thoughts and your analysis on it? And are there any pitfalls in using those? Because I would imagine that the people who are buying are not actually liking it. So, yeah.
Yeah, so it goes in the ad mediation direction. You're right, there are more and more of those ad mediators also providing like additional services on top. I think it mainly depends how important ads are, right, for you. So as in, if it's main business for you, then you should build the expertise in-house to, for example, talk to the ad networks and negotiate with them, right? If it's kind of like a side business for you, I don't know, let's say 10-15% of your overall revenues, your overall revenues are not massive, then yeah, sure, I would outsource it. And then it really makes sense to talk to all those different providers. Some have more tech, some have less tech, some have like a different auction model. And that's like something that you need to figure out, but also understand how much influence you can actually have on the optimization. The more you make, the less I would give the business and the responsibility to an outside company and really like own it in-house. And there are very sophisticated players when it comes, there are some companies that are very sophisticated in optimizing the ad setup, but this only makes sense if you really have like a massive business, otherwise it would outsource it.
Yeah, I would add on to that. I mean, the further you are from the advertiser dollar, in general, the lower the returns are gonna be. So, you know, like John is saying, you know, we see companies utilize these companies when maybe they don't have the team to manage that. But if you have the resources and the time, then it definitely makes sense to work direct. Now, some of those companies have great tech, which you can utilize. You don't need to build all your own tech to kind of mediate your ad providers. So that's where they really have great value for you, I would say. Sorry, I couldn't hear the question.
But is that advisable? And are there any pitfalls in using the ad mediators?
Pitfalls? The pitfall is how much control you can have. So this is where a lot of companies decide, okay, do I build it myself or do I use what's off the shelf? So similar to any other tool, like a game engine or anything like that, right? You would say, okay, maybe this tool isn't perfect, but I don't need to build it. So the pitfall might be it doesn't have all the features you're looking for. But if you're going to build it yourself, there's definitely massive headaches that come with doing that. Those break, it's very hard to maybe plug in networks like AppLovin and Bungle into a custom-made mediation layer.
Got it. Thanks a lot.
Guys, we are really out of time, but if anyone has a very quick question, we can manage very quick one.
Hi, your general advice for advertising, how to advertise when we have less budgets, especially indies?
Good one. If I finish, sure. So first of all, it's you need to start somewhere, right? So like I think like the either the so we have already covered a couple of this. First of all, definitely understand your market, right? So you invest into like at the very beginning, it makes sense to really understand like the market that you're in, understand your competitors, and really understand how they actually do business and what is important for their growth. There are tools, like some of them are unfortunately pretty expensive, that give you like really detailed insights on in how your competitors operate, and this is great. So there's a lot of transparency in our market, which is beautiful on the one side, but also a curse on the other side. But especially if you're new to the space, then it's obviously like an enormous advantage to understand your competition and have like a proper like or really understand what you're getting into. And from there, having like a pretty agile setup that you can iterate on is, from my perspective, definitely the way to go. But you also need to understand how much data you can actually and how to acquire the data, and that is something that's still pretty interesting from my perspective. That like indies, like first, that's actually more important. If you're going like if you're an indie just to create content, then forget it. So my impression of many indie developers is that it's content only, and there's no like entrepreneurial drive behind it. This doesn't work. It's a super competitive market. If you're successful, you need to build a company, you need to be entrepreneurial, you need to think like an entrepreneur. Just content usually doesn't survive. You will get, hopefully, a feature, and then you'll die, almost like that. So therefore, that's the most important thing for indies. You need to build a company if you want to be successful. It needs to be sustainable, having a sustainable setup, and understanding that it's more than content, even though like the indie definitions are a bit different, sorry for going a bit too far, maybe.
I think you can look at some markets where indies have made it work. So if you look at Australia, similar to India, they have people who have great tech knowledge, right? So they work for some really good companies, they've learned a lot. And so they're utilizing that to make great games. And yes, it's, if you work off of a featured only business model, it is very risky, it's very difficult to make that work. So yes, you have to plan like a business. I think that's very smart. Now, you don't necessarily need to compete on the user acquisition side. I mean, if you only have, let's say, 3 or 5 people versus a Zynga that has 3 to 5,000 people, I mean, your dollars per headcount is a very different equation. So that's, I think, how you can consider competing, right? You may not be able to make the same amount of money as a company that size, but you have to imagine that, you're maybe just a handful of people versus thousands of people. So I think that's a consideration that a lot of people don't take into account.
Great. Thank you so much, guys. Really appreciate it. I guess that's all we have today. Great. Thank you so much. And guys, a big round of applause for all the interpreters here.